Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Welcome to another session of Startup Grind Bratislava. Tonight we have a very special host, guest coming out of Stockholm from the Nordics. He's currently a chairman of Fluent Capital, one of the leading venture capital funds based out of London. He's also a board member of Creandum, another leading VC from Nordics. You might know some of the investments such as Spotify and Vimeo, which we'll touch during the discussion. If you have any questions, also please go ahead to slido.com and use the hashtag SUG. I will leave maybe 10 to 15 minutes at the end to ask the questions. So, and I'll choose the best ones. So please go ahead and vote for the most interesting ones. Before we kick off with the first set of questions, I would like to mention that Startup Grind is a global initiative. We are a global community of entrepreneurs. We are based in more than 200 cities and 100 countries, and altogether we count up to 1 million entrepreneurs. So that's a pretty incredible and powerful community which we are part of, and you are part of at the same time. So congrats. Before we really kick off, I would like to thank also our main sponsor, Slovak Telecom, who is making this event possible. All right, so without further ado, please give it up for Martin, and we'll start with the first question, please.
Hello everyone, and thank you for inviting me. It's not the first time I'm here in Bratislava, but it's the first time I'm here at O100 house and facility. I must say I'm very impressed. And of course, I'm the father of this young man, beautiful young man standing there.
Very beautiful.
He has made me very proud, together with his partners, Marek, Dusan, and Michael. They are running this, and I must say congratulations. I think it's a great success, and you know, walking around here today gives me the kind of feeling that you get when you come into a startup environment and where you see that value is created, and you get that feeling of energy, which is so important to bring society forward. I have talked to a number of companies today, and I must say I've been here several times over the last few years, and every time I'm here I see that there is an increased level, there's an increased quality on the deals, and on behalf of the Slovakian startup community, I'm very optimistic. So congratulations to everyone.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that. We're doing our best. We really try to make this an international hub. So we're on a mission. Let's see what's happening in the next 2 years. Right, so let me start and kick off with the first set of questions. I usually start with the background. So I'll jump right into that. Could you take us through where you grew up, where you're from, basics?
So I am a Norwegian. I'm born in Oslo in Norway. My parents comes from a fishing town up on the northwest coast called Ålesund. I have grown up in a small city on the southern coast that's called Risør, which I consider being my hometown. I am the son of a guy who were badly treated during World War II, came home, as many of these people that had escaped from Norway, being part of the merchant marine in Europe and in the US, being on the convoys, and who suffered severely from post-traumatic syndrome, with all the impacts this had, including a lot of alcohol and so on. And that was my growing up, and I very early understood that, you know, I am the master of my own destiny. I need to be able to take care of myself, I need to be able to take care of my family, and I can't expect to get help from everywhere. And this has, in a way, colored my my life, my career as well. So, but there has been some bumps in the road also for me. I dropped out of high school. I ran away from home. I was 17. I was sick and tired of everything. I jumped on a ship. And I was an engine boy, and you know, I washed, I cleaned the floors in the engine room on a ship sailing back and forth in the Pacific Ocean, and I learned something about working. And you know, when you everyday work is about cleaning oil spill and washing, you start dreaming of something else. My sailor career was interrupted very abruptly when I fell down inside a day tank and severely hurt myself and was hospitalized, 17 years old, in a hospital alone in Japan. And I got a little more than a month to think through things. And I decided maybe I should go back to school. So I did, and I did my high school, I did my university, and I got a master's degree in technology. This is becoming a long story, but you asked me, so I used the opportunity. I like.
It's nice.
At home, my wife doesn't allow me talking at all, you know, so this is my, this is my chance. So I finished university, and I did what my parents wanted me to do, get myself a proper job, corporate. Corporate jobs, you know, that's, I don't know if you tried, but it's not that exciting. So it lasted only for a few years. Then, drinking some beers together with some friends, we got an idea, a business idea. We had learned that in the court, you could buy companies for $1, 1 krona, if they were bankrupt. And you know, if you do something about these companies, we can probably sell them for some more. So that was the business idea, not very sophisticated. And we did. We bought a company for 1 krona, and we discovered that we needed working capital. And I had to do my first fundraising, and thanks to people that were smarter than me, and my partners, we were actually three guys doing this, we managed to get working capital. And we turned the company around and we sold it. And we were very proud. And this went on for a couple of times. We did it a couple of times, and very hard work. And this, in a way, triggered my entrepreneurship soul. So after this, I basically became an entrepreneur, and I was that for a long time.
And what age was this?
What age I was? So I was in my 20s, late 20s, when we did these turnaround operations. And I continued doing that until I was 31. Then I did my first real startup, so running proper companies, and then starting building companies and exited them, and we did this actually for some years.
So basically jumping into almost like investment role right off the bat, right? Would you say that the team you kind of had at the beginning in your first kind of company, what made you kind of work so long together? Like, what was the essence?
well, afraid of turning bankrupt. you know, we were on the edge of being, because the company was bankrupt when we took it over, and we were on the edge of being turned into the court as a bankrupt estate again. And, you don't leave the office at that point in time. But you learn to solve problems. You learn to stay alive and fight. I know how it feels to be close to a payday for your employees and not having the money in the bank necessary to execute the payment. You don't sleep very well then. But you only know that you have to fix it. We fixed it. We got some help from some customers. We got some help from some banks, from some investors, and we managed to get around those hurdles as well.
And so then you were 31, and then you started your first startup. What was that about?
So actually, from 31 until I was in my 40s, I ran software companies. So it's a software combined with hardware in some instances, and I'll just mention one because this was pre-internet, and there was an Olympic game in Norway in Lillehammer in 1994. And we had the honor of being the supplier of information terminals. It sounds like internet, but it wasn't. There was a cable going out from them. And we provided the information about the participants, the games, and results. And this was partly a design task, because these information terminals were formed in the Lillehammer under the Lillehammer design program, and of course this was an early stage information terminal which later turned into the internet business.
Do you have kind of any big learnings from the early days, except being on the edge of the working capital? Any kind of the fails early days that you would kind of recommend to our audience not to do? Or like, not to, I mean, how to avoid these early fuck-ups?
Yeah, that's the right word. So there's a number of learnings. And now when I'm working with entrepreneurs, I try to convey some of these learnings to new entrepreneurs. One of them is to manage expectations, because you work with your employees, you work with your investors, you work with your customers, and there is one saying which I have made mine, which is under promise, over deliver. Don't go to because this we see it over and over again. You know, I meet an entrepreneur. He shows me a slide on how much money he is going to make just after the next 3 months when he maybe has got some money. And it always points against heaven. Have you seen it? And what happens is that investors seeing this, they wait. I like to wait and see what it comes back with next month, and the month after that, and the month after that. Because I, as an investor, I don't put a lot of money on the table if I meet you first time. You know, it's like with the girls, maybe. But, yeah. It's so much better, and we have seen, and I have learned, you know, under promise, go and say I will do this much, come back and say I did this much. Promise 50, deliver 100. You know, if you promise 50 and deliver only 80, you're still a hero. But if you promise 100 and deliver 80, you're not a hero. You have overpromised. So I think that's maybe one key key learning. And the other, you know, I will mention one more thing that is so important. Make sure that you have an attractive place for people to be. It doesn't mean that you have to pay a lot, but make, you know, when I walked in here, I got this feeling, you know, this is a place I would like to work as well. And make sure that you as entrepreneurs, when you create environments for people to join you, make it a nice place. Make it friendly, open, and sharing. I think that's my second one.
Okay. You're an investor at the moment, before you were an entrepreneur. So I guess you raised some capital. Could you tell us about your experience raising a capital from the entrepreneur's perspective?
Yeah, so again, don't expect the investor to put money on the table the first time you meet. I think that's it's important. Don't be disappointed if the investors says it's I'm not ready yet. I need to learn more about it. And this was the case when I did, I would say, my first real fundraising. This is 20 years ago. We had started an internet company, a company called Interaction Design, which became a Nordic company. And Interaction Design, we did have a revenue stream very early on. We made home pages in 96, 97, 98. And we wanted to expand the business, and we needed money. But what we did was that we built a relation with a couple of investors and fed them with information over a couple of months. And then one of them came back and said, you know, it looks like you underpromise and overdeliver. He didn't use that word, but that was the feeling. And that was our tactics as well. And he put the money on the table, and we had the money needed for doing the expansion. And we sold the company in 99 and managed to get our money before things crashed only a year after. And that was actually the funding I have used actually up to now to support myself and the further investments I've been doing.
Your another venture is Creandum. As I understand, it's a digital marketing agency at the moment. Could you tell us a bit more about this venture?
Yeah. So it's a continuation of what I said earlier on, the Interaction Design company that we had established in Norway, Sweden, and Denmark was acquired by a Swedish company called Adcore in 99. This was a company that we very hyped did an IPO on the Stockholm Stock Exchange. And in 2001, they dipped, and they dipped so deep that they almost went bankrupt, but they didn't. And I saw the opportunity of doing what we call a management buyout. So I recruited a childhood friend of mine called Svein Stavlin from my hometown on the south coast of Norway called Risør. And together we bought what I earlier sold to Adcore and established Creandum. What we didn't understand in 2001 was that what we believed was that we would have a little dip in the market, just a little dip. We didn't understand that it was a Norwegian mountain that you were going to slide down. But you know, I've been out a winter night before, so we did bring in a venture firm, an investor from Bergen, And in the beginning, I think Svein, my partner and I, we owned about 90% of, and the founders owned about 90% of the company. And this investor had maybe 10, or I don't remember the exact numbers, but about 10%. 2 years later, down this Norwegian mountain, the investor had 90%, and 10% was left to the founders. The climate was slightly different. So it was time to move on. But we saved the money, saved the company. I managed actually to sell my shares a little later after I left Creandum and make a profit the second time of actually the same company that were developed over these years. So I made a double exit on my company then. But in 2003, I decided that my entrepreneur career was close to an end, and I wanted to do something different, and I started to angel invest.
Okay, so I know that Creandum started in 2004. You were one of the founding partners?
No.
So how did it start? Could tell us about the transformation from an entrepreneur into, okay, angel and a VC.
So, in 2003, I considered myself, we had saved the company, I made a double exit. I considered myself pretty smart. So I started angel investing. And it didn't take many months before I understood that smart entrepreneurs are not necessarily, at least not in my case, smart angel investors. So I slowed down that activity. I did some law studies in between her. And then I came in touch with two guys who were the founders of a company called Creandum. They had just started the company with the help of two major investors in Sweden, the 6th AP Fund and Scandia Life Insurance. And they needed a third partner. So, and these two guys were Swedes. I was a Norwegian living in Copenhagen. I had actually been running a company out of Sweden, which was Adcore earlier on. So I had a Nordic profile. So I came on board as a kind of the international guy to this team, and there were three partners. This was the beginning of Creandum, but I was not a founder of Creandum. But we started investing then from our first fund.
Now, Creandum is well known for very interesting investments. What was the first investment of Creandum? It's a hard one, huh?
I honestly don't remember which one was the first one. We spent a long time making analysis of the market, and we invested in the Swedish market only at that time, and we invested in early stage hardware companies, mostly semiconductor companies, and it took some time before we understood that that's difficult. It's very difficult, the semiconductor business, even some 15 years ago, almost 15 years ago, was a difficult segment. But we managed to do some good investments, and the fund is, the first one was not very successful, but it's recently been IPO'd, one of the companies from this fund called Edgeware, which is in the video distribution sector, and it's a very successful IPO. So first bond is okay.
Most of the people in the audience know about Spotify, right? Who knows? Yeah, all right. Who knows about Vivino? This is their second, or like one of the other successful companies. Okay, some hands up. I think everybody's interested in these kind of major stories. When you were making an investment into Spotify, you were one of the first institutional investors. Is that right?
No, we were the first institutional investor, together with Nordsong from Norway. We were two investors syndicating that investment, and we were the first real investors in Spotify. And
how did you identify this opportunity?
So it was my partner Frederick who deserves the honor of spotting Spotify. we picked up information about this from a guy who has later become a co-investor of mine called Andreas Hen, who is not a founder of Spotify, but he was the first employee. And I think the story is so that he gave a presentation at the university in Stockholm, and my partner Frederick was there listening to this and saying, "This is interesting." and then we came into a process with the guys, and there were two things I think that at least for me was determining. It was a market opportunity. It was a big problem. You probably remember, you know, all of us, including me, were copying music illegally. The record labels were not making much money, and it was a huge problem. And you know, it was out of control. The music consumption was out of control, and something had to happen. And the music market is fairly big. It's big enough to build a billion-dollar company, which is now at least almost proven. The other thing that was determining for us and for me was two world-class founders, Daniel Ek and Martin Lundsson, were, you know, world-class.
So what made them world class? I mean, there are so many entrepreneurs you meet on a daily basis. How do you identify these guys are the ones that make it a unicorn?
So these guys were not first time entrepreneurs. They had done it before. So of course that was an advantage. You don't necessarily have to be a second time or third time entrepreneur to be successful. But there's a couple of things I think is very important. And one of them is the mix between the entrepreneurs. They have to be able to work together, but they also have to fulfill each other. You know, the competence that they have together should be more than the competence of each one of them summed up. The entrepreneurs, they need to have something I call recruitment power, the ability to attract people, in fact better than themselves, to work on their venture. And this recruitment power is unfortunately something we are missing from time to time. And for me, that is a turnoff. When I look people in the eyes, I always ask myself the question, would I work for this guy? Would I actually work for you? If I don't want to work for him or her, then probably you don't want to work for him or her. And then it's more difficult. These two guys in Spotify, our strong belief was that they had what was needed. So world-class entrepreneurs.
Were there any struggles in the early days with Spotify? Did you ever think that they're going to shut down and it won't work?
Oh, you know, Spotify was just a line straight into heaven. No, of course not. No, you know, every startup have struggles. And when you grow, and you grow and you become really big, you get also enemies. You get people that are competing with you, people that really want you out of the market, and of course Spotify had to face struggles on their way up, like every other company. But again, you know, it was a kind of entrepreneurs that are able to solve problems, work around problems, you know, keep their organizations behind them and just continue. And you know, I often use the example of a good entrepreneur is one that can climb a high mountain, find a cliff, 600 meters straight down to the ground, jump off the cliff, and bet that he's going to solve the problem with the landing before he hits the ground.
Well, maybe we can test it one day. do you think there are any other opportunities in the music industry these days? Like, do you think the Spotify can spin off into different verticals, or where do you think we will head?
So Spotify is today a source in Stockholm for new startups. We have learned, the Stockholm environment is quite developed. And what we see in this environment is that new good startups comes out of the last generation startups. So yes, there are good entrepreneurs spinning off Spotify that have been there for some time. Some of them become angel investors, like Andreas Ehn, who I mentioned, who is a co-investor with me in Automile. Others are spin-off where Spotify is still engaged. We have an excellent example now rolling out in the Nordics, which are aiming for the part of the market that Spotify is not targeting, which is the professional market, where institutions, restaurants, and so on want to play music, because it's a slightly different game than the consumer game. Soundtrack Your Brand, which is the name of the company, is of course another great startup coming out of a great startup.
Another investment that you led is Vivino. If you guys drink wine, you definitely need to download it now. It's one of the best food apps you can get, so please go ahead. We used it yesterday, it was pretty good. You spotted the guys, right? The team.
So Vivino was discovered like this. It's we were a bunch of guys. I'm sorry, there were no girls there. I'm sorry. We were a bunch of guys sitting around a table, and one of them pulls up his phone and says, "I have an app that can recognize wine bottles." Oh. And we tested the app and we took pictures of wine bottles. It didn't recognize any. So I brought up some more bottles and we tested it. It didn't recognize any. So we put it aside and we kept on drinking and we had a happy night. In the morning when I woke up with a slight hangover, I was thinking of this, you know, if you can recognize the wine bottles when you sit around the table, you know, we can probably spin something around this. But of course this had to be an American company, you know, good ideas always come from America. But when I got out of bed, I checked it up and I found out that this company is actually in Copenhagen. A few days later, I was in front of the CEO of this startup, confronted him with the fact that it didn't work. And he said, well, you know, the way we actually do it is that you take a picture, we just need some time because we send the picture to India and they Google it. And then if you can't make it, you fake it. But the idea was good. And this guy, you know, he comes from a place where they absolutely are not known for wine, which is the Faroe Islands. And he came to Copenhagen and into this one of the shops, you know, and the shelves were full of wine bottles and he's standing in front of them and looking at it and he has no idea what to buy. And he thought, you know, some other people is probably having the same problem. And that was the beginning of Vivino. So we recommended our fund to invest in Vivino. And the agenda was to bring Vivino out of Denmark into a bigger market, to the US. And we managed to get Bolderton in London interested. So Bolderton wrote a big check as well. And we took the company to the US, to San Francisco, where they are headquartered today. Now, Vivino is just turning into the biggest wine distributor, or wine app where you can buy wine on the internet, and most probably in a year or two, we will be the biggest wine distributor in the world. And this is a story about growth. And Vivino is my baby. I found it. I did the investment. I'm very proud of it. And I was sitting in front of the CEO just 2 weeks ago, together with Rebecca. I don't know where Rebecca is, my junior partner. There she is. She's working together with me in Stockholm and everywhere else where we are going. We talked about what did it take Vivino from this little company, which had a room, like one of the small rooms over here at the university in Copenhagen, to where they are today, located very centrally on Market Street in San Francisco. And one of the secrets, which I haven't told you guys about, is that we and it was not actually Creandum and my idea. I'm not going to credit myself for this, but it's a big learning. We brought the OKR system into Vivino. It has been such a great help. OKR, objectives and key results, is a system, an infrastructure you build to control your company from its very small until it's very big. It's developed by the Google team, who has used it all the way from almost the very beginning until today. It's still in use. And for me, OKR is a must in all the companies I invest in. And it's highly recommended to everyone. Take a look at OKR and trigger Rebecca an email if you have questions around it. She's an expert.
Okay, so is it that simple to scale a company, which is OKR? I mean, Denmark, how the market is like 5.5 million, Slovakia is 5 million. Why don't people scale B2C companies from Slovakia and they managed from Denmark? What was the ingredients?
So you just take a huge market, solve a big problem, find some fantastic entrepreneurs, mix it with some OKRs, and you have a $1 billion company.
Hope you have no doubt.
You have more questions? No, you know, honestly, it's a long way, and of course you need a lot of factors to come your way. But most of all, you have to be able to attract good people. Attracting good people, it's so important. I am an angel investor now, and I got a question from someone here earlier on. You know, when you are an angel investor, you invest very early in the company. I have no numbers to put in an Excel sheet. I can't analyze the numbers. I can't discount the cash flow to find out the value. I have no clue whether they. You know, it's very difficult to determine whether this company will have revenue at all. You know, in this and that time. So I have to look for different things. So what I am looking for is, just as I said, I am looking for the market opportunity. It has to be there, and I have to understand that the entrepreneur understands the market opportunity. And therefore, I very often ask the entrepreneur, how big is your market? And too often I get the answer, oh, it's 100 billion, 10 billion, 50 billion. Okay, tell me, where is this market? Who has it? and why are you able to take a substantial share of this market? And then, of course, I have trapped the entrepreneur into you know, a discussion around what is his actual market, accessible market, TAM. And that's difficult, but it's a job that has to be done by every entrepreneur that want to meet professional investors. You have to understand the details of your market. You have to know your competitors. You have to know as much as possible of what they are going to do, and have hypotheses about the direction they are following compared to what you are going to do and what you are going to catch on market share.
Year and a half ago, you stepped down from Creandum, and you became a board member that allows you basically to have more space for angel investments. Could you tell us something about your angel investments, how they're doing?
I'm very proud of my angel investments. You know, I've done five of them. I've exited one. One I did just a month ago, so I can't say whether it's a success or not, but the three others are companies that are running very well. The first one I did was a company called Automile. It was an entrepreneur that I had recommended Creandum to invest in earlier on, in a company called Jace, making headphones. That didn't become a success. The company is still on the Stockholm Stock Exchange, doing okay, but not a venture success. And the entrepreneur left the company, and a few years later, he started the Automile company, and he came to me and asked me for help to make sure that he didn't fail again. And I joined. I bought some founder shares. I took the role as a chairman, and together we worked on fundraising. We worked on building the company, making the structure. We decided to move the company from Stockholm to the US. This has, you know, I've done this multiple times, so I know a little bit about it. Today, Automile is based in Silicon Valley, in Palo Alto, and are doing very well and have U.S. investors on board. So, for me as an angel investor, it was time to pull back. And from 1st of January, I'm not anymore on the board of Automile. I'm still an investor. So then I have two other companies, Norwegian companies. One company I've been together with almost since the start. It's a 1.5-year-old company called No Isolation. It's a beautiful little company. It's female driven. And just as a parenthesis, I am a big supporter of bringing more females into this industry. There is too few of you. I need to see more females in the room. There are 50% females in general, and there should be 50% here as well, but it's not. Even though it's not too bad, but I want to see more. And No Isolation launched their product in August last year. So we went from zero in revenue to about $100,000 per month right now. And we are growing very rapidly. It's a fast growing company. We have just moved the company, or actually the founder, from Norway to Amsterdam to start selling on the European market. It looks very promising. And it's a fast growing company targeting isolation, which is big problem in society. People are isolated. We started with small kids. A lot of them have different kind of problems. Some have cancer, can't attend school, can't be out with their friends. And we have made equipment so they can stay in touch with their peer group. Last company I will mention is Vibeo, making 1-minute videos for social media. The attention span that most of us
including me, have when we are looking at social media is about 1 minute. Then I'm scrolling, a maximum 1 minute, I would say. Then we are scrolling down our Facebook feed or LinkedIn feed or whatever we are looking at. And they make videos. Started with doing it for startups because we do it at a very low cost. But then we were discovered by corporates. So corporates discovered that they could get 10 videos for very small money. So now we have almost a waiting list of from corporates who want to create live videos for social media. So yeah, that's and I also do fund investment. So I have a couple of fund in addition to Creandum. I have two fund investments that you mentioned in London. Yes.
Mm-hmm. What about investments that didn't go so well?
I was afraid you were going to ask that question. Of course, I have investments that hasn't turned out well. Jace is absolutely one of them. We made headphones. And we didn't succeed. There were many reasons for us not to succeed, but making hardware where you don't necessarily have a good enough margin is very difficult, and it's very difficult for startups who don't have the necessary negotiation power when you are dealing with manufacturers, often in China, that are going to produce for you and who require you to pay months before you get the delivery, and then you get the delivery and you are going to sell to distributors who will ask you for payment terms where it will take months before you get money on your account. So we ended up in a situation where we more or less had to say no to orders, because the more we sold, the more money the investors had to put on the table. And you know, that makes it almost mission impossible. So we had to slow down the growth, and we decided to leave the company. And we ended up IPOing the company and take down the activity to a level where they can survive. And they are doing quite okay today. So they are still supplying Jay's headphones, and I'm still a customer.
I think I know that there are some founders here that are looking for their first early stage investments, with probably angel investment. And there are some angels in this region, Austria, Slovakia, and Czech Republic. What would you suggest that is the right kind of model for angels to enter a company at such an early stage? What is the healthy model, let's put it this way, for angels to go into a company?
So, angels, angels are much easier to deal with than VCs. VCs is very often VCs require terms that might be difficult to understand, might be quite harsh when it comes to taking control of the company. Angels are much more betting on the entrepreneurs, working together with the entrepreneurs. But then again, VCs come with bigger money than the angels does. I must say, I am an angel investor, and I am here looking for opportunities. I think it's a great place to look. And my two reasons for that is one, the opportunity that is here. I think this is an up and coming environment. I have got a network here. I know a few people down here, and which might be helpful to me in a case where I found a startup that I wanted to invest in, that could be close to the company and might be able to co-invest with me or at least help me staying in touch with the company. And the other thing, which is also important, is that this little town of Bratislava and state of Slovakia is not really discovered by the big players who can probably outcompete me. So I'm not telling anyone about this. I'm keeping it to myself, you know, and I want to pick the gemstones from this startup environment. No, it's not really true. I am telling about you, but I think the competitive situation down here when it comes to investments are very different from what it is in Berlin, London, and Stockholm.
I think we have like 12, 13 minutes left, so let me jump to the last section and then we go to Slido. Yeah, we have some questions. Okay, so what are your future plans now? You're chairman of Frog Capital. What's up with that?
So, you know, my father once said to me, because, you know, I had long hair, and you know, I didn't dress very properly, and I was just coming home as a sailor, and he said his dream when it came to me was that I would cut my hair and get myself a proper job. And I'm thinking about that. Maybe I should get a proper job. That's it is something with a proper job. No, that's a joke. But when I left Creandum, in the Creandum investment team almost two years ago, I was thinking about slowing down. That has not been very successful. And the reason for that not being successful is that I enjoy doing what I'm doing so much that I can't stop. I'm like a drug addict, you know. It's this is the most fantastic thing I can think of doing. I love speaking to entrepreneurs. I love hearing your pitches. Maybe some of my investments will turn into real money. I'm sure they will, because they look very good now. and that will be in a way a proof point. But I'm not driven by the money. I'm driven about the joy I get from what I'm doing, from the funds where I'm participating, being in Frog Capital, doing a little later stage kind of investment, seeing entrepreneurs that are not raising seed capital but doing A and B rounds, but also doing my angel investments, visiting here. Next week, Rebecca and I are going to Shanghai, to China, and also looking for investment opportunities early stage. You know, it's a fantastic thing to do. I love it. I can't stop.
I actually have maybe two last questions. So you said you're starting to kind of recognize the local startup community. Do you have any suggestions what the entrepreneurs should take on in a very early stage community? Any improvements?
Well, I have to criticize some of you a little bit, because one of the things that you would benefit from is to improving your English. Now there's a Brit sitting here, and he can probably agree with me. You know, you speak English, but we can clearly hear that you don't have that everyday training in being fluent in English. And I think we've been through this multiple times when I've been here. And this is an Eastern Europe and French and, you know, the Latin part of Europe kind of problem. There are some places where English is not as established as it is elsewhere. And when you come in a situation where you are going to get US money, go to London to get money, you have to be able to have an intense dialogue without stumbling when it comes to speaking. But on the other side, just keep up the good work. I mean, there are so many great ideas here. There are so many exciting things going on. You are hardworking. It's a place where the will is there. And I'm feeling very confident that we will see great companies coming out of Slovakia and Bratislava in the near future. I just hope that I will be one of the investors.
Pretty awesome. All right, so let me jump into the questions from Slido. And I think actually I will take a stand here because I'm not old, but my knees are hurting. What is the one book you have gifted the most to others?
It's a book that I was actually given when I started in Creandum. It's a book called Done Deals. Done Deals is the book about the great VCs on Sand Hill Road in Silicon Valley. I got it 12, 13 years ago. I gave it to Rebecca, wherever she is. To read, I think I've given it to my son as well. If you want to learn about the venture capital environment, I would say that 90% that's in this book is still valid today. It's good reading. It's the history of venture capital.
I think we kind of touched on this in our conversation, but maybe in kind of bullet points. What is the main thing you look for in a startup?
I think I touched upon that. The market opportunity and the entrepreneur. Those that have been through a process where I have invested, they can tell you that the kind of interviews that you have with me before I invest are interviews that you only will experience once in your life. I really drill deep down in your head and I ask you all kind of peculiar questions that you had never expected anyone to ask. And I do expect you to answer as well, and that's the worst thing.
What is the worst advice you hear often in the world of startups? Worst advice?
The risk is too high. When people pull out because they see risks, they are not, as I said, you have to be able to jump off the cliff and bet on that you are able to solve the problem with a landing before you hit the ground. When people tell me it's too risky, then the conversation is over.
And contrary to best advice, maybe it's the same person asking, right? what is the best advice you've ever been given to you?
So I think, if I look at my own finances, the best advice has been, don't take those money. And this is too public, but there was a certain situation where I could take corporate money into my company, our startup, and we had a discussion around it. It was very tempting because it was real money. But we said no, and we struggled through a period where we absolutely could have made use of those money, but we didn't. And we were down in the valley, and then the valley of death, and then we came up again, and then we sold the company. And thanks to not taking those money, we made a great profit.
I actually have a question following up on this topic. There are some startups that are thinking of having a strategic investor, so a corporate investor. Would you recommend this to get such guys like CVCs on board?
So it's, you know, I can't say that I don't recommend it. In certain situations, it might be the right thing to do. What is very important is that you make sure that the agreement you make, the shareholder agreement you make, the agreement you make with the corporate investor is so that it doesn't deteriorate the value of your startup in an exit situation where perhaps a competitor of this corporate wants to buy your company. Because when a corporate, very often, not all, and it's very, I should be careful not generalizing here, but often when a corporate invests, it's with an agenda that if your company works well, becomes successful, they want to take it over. They don't want their competitors to step in and snap that company, and they want to make sure that they have this opportunity when they make the agreement with you. So too often corporates are limiting the upside for the entrepreneurs, but not always.
Okay, I think we'll take two more questions before we close this session. What is the typical age of the company you invest the seed and series A round?
So I like to invest in very new, as an angel, I like to invest in very new companies. Preferably a year, 2 years, maybe 3 years old, but my limit is about there. So if I look at the companies I have been investing in, they have been less than a year old. And when you get angels like me on board, you should know that they, most of them, will prefer to come in very early. It's I think I add great value to my investments, my startups, especially those that where I take an active role, I want to get in at a low price to participate with the upside. I think it's valuable. I'm sure it's very valuable for most startups, at least when they are first-time entrepreneurs, to have an experienced angel on board very early. I came in contact with a beautiful company. I had a call from an entrepreneur who had a great idea. I was mesmerized by the idea in a fintech company. Rebecca and I went to meet the company, to meet the entrepreneur, and he was my kind of guy. Then I had a second meeting, physical meeting with the entrepreneur, where I met the others, and we went through more details, actually in London. And I understood that they had done serious mistakes when they took in a group of inexperienced angels earlier on. And the structure, I can't go into details, but the structure of that financing was so that it was a mission impossible to finance it further. So I had to pass, and so has every other professional investor that have been looking at it, because a lot of people have been looking at it, because it's such a great idea and it's such a great team, but they stumbled when they met the first inexperienced investors.
Based on what do you assume where a company is going to achieve a breakout success?
Can you say that again?
Based on what do you assume whether a company is going to achieve a breakout success?
You know, it's all about growth. The kind of companies I invest in are all about growth. So And I think I talked to some of you earlier today. You know, if you are a startup, and especially if you are in the SaaS business, software as a service, it's about growth. And when you have got a number of customers, we are talking, maybe after 6-12 months of sales, you need to show that you you are going to do a decent seed round, maybe an early A round. You have to show a great growth rate of at least 20% month over month in recurring revenue. 20% is a threshold. I usually tell entrepreneurs that if you have 20% growth in recurring revenue month over month, I can almost guarantee you that you will be financed. If you have 15, it's possible. We're talking early days now. So if you have 15, it's possible, but it's a risk. Then I would have to look into other parameters and evaluate the case. If you have 10, I will probably pass.
Okay, and
maybe I'm too harsh now.
All right, let's take the last question before we close this. So, what are two things that you worry and look forward to?
I look forward to my next entrepreneur. That will be one of my my portfolio companies. You know, it's. I love entrepreneurs and the energy they give to their employees and they share with me, and when I find a case I want to invest in, it's almost like winning in a lottery, when I get that feeling that this is something I want to do. I'm looking forward to it. Exits, yes, but exits, exit is about receiving a check and saying bye-bye. It's not that, it's okay to get the money and then I can do more investments, but that's not a big problem, but on the other side, exits are the confirmation that I'm doing the right things when I do my investments as well. So it's a kind of confirmation and makes me feel good as well.
Anything you worry about?
Oh, there's so many things to worry about. Of course, I worry about the macroeconomic and the macro environment presently. There's such a lot of things, these British guys with the Brexit, and Scotland and all the right-wing people that my father gave almost his life for to fight, that are now marching again, and a lot of them in Eastern Europe, makes me worried. The movement against immigration is a threat to all of us. I don't know how many nations you have here, but one of the driving forces in Silicon Valley has been immigration. And now people that are not so smart, they find out that immigration shouldn't be there. We have a big challenge in Europe. People are dying on our doorstep. Small children are floating around on the beaches in the Mediterranean. It's enough things to worry about. When I look into to the startup community, I'm always worried about the regulators. Will they do the right things to stimulate growth in this area? Because the startups of today will be the big companies of tomorrow that are going to carry the European nations into the future. So it's enough things to worry about. But I'm trying not to think too much about it. Concentrate on the positive things.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it was Martin Hauge. Give it up, please. Thank you.
Thank you.